In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Good morning and welcome to our Eucharist today as we celebrate not only the seventh Sunday of Eastertide, but also this is the Sunday which follows Ascensiontide. So our first reading this morning will have that episode mentioned, and we will consider that as we go through our service today. You're very warmly welcome to Mitcham Parish Church. Christ, our Passover Lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore rejoice by putting away all malice and evil and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. Lord Jesus, you raise us to new life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you forgive us our sins. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you feed us with the living bread. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from all your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. Come to the collect for this Sunday, let us pray. Risen, ascended Lord, as we rejoice at your triumph, fill your church on earth with power and compassion, that all who are estranged by sin may find forgiveness and know your peace, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. We pay attention to our first reading.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over the course of 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers. Together, the crowd numbered about 120 people. He said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry." So one of the men who have accompanied us throughout the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection. So they proposed two: Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias. And he was added to the 11 apostles. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Rejoice, says the Lord, because I am going to the Father. Alleluia. Hallelujah. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
In the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus looked up to heaven and prayed, Father, I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world, so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the word has hated them, because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I speak in God's name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please make yourselves comfortable. You know, one of the ways we try to make sense of the present is by consulting the past. When we try to figure out why things have turned out the way they have, we often search the past for an explanation. And you've only got to look at the shouts for inquiries at the moment to understand what that means in our current situation. So ancient voices are listened to with new attention. Old texts are consulted with a new eye. Past events are scrutinized anew. That human effort of making sense of the present by rereading the past is one that was used widely in the early church. So things may be seen to happen, so that the scriptures might be fulfilled. And just so in today's first reading, we hear Peter saying, Brothers, the passage of scripture has been fulfilled in which the Holy Spirit, speaking through David, foretells the fate of Judas, who offered himself as a guide to the men who arrested Jesus. In the book of Psalms it says, Let someone else take his office. Peter claims the past as a reinforcement of the present. A past once skimmed over now becomes part of the church's reference points. And the past takes on a new significance because of what is happening now. The activity of bringing the past up to date is one that we all engage in from time to time. We review the past in the light of a new experience, and in the process we begin to see a shape to our stories. Dates become more important as we begin to see how our previous history contains pointers to our present situations, how everything is connected. And a pattern slowly emerges. Things begin to make sense. In today's first reading, you can see the attempts of the early church to make sense of all the recent chaotic happenings. They scour the past for signs, for indications, for clues. But when they come to look at the future of the church and choose a successor to Judas, their faith takes a somewhat riskier turn. They nominate candidates, pray together and then draw lots. As one commentator has put it, it's a little husting, a little prayer, then roll the dice. For all it's worth, the past cannot provide solutions to all their needs. The time comes when the disciples must go through the door into the dark without being sure if the future will confirm their choice to be the right one. Our venture in faith, like theirs, needs the support of the past and readiness to roll the dice occasionally. We have to take the risk. By definition, if you'll forgive the Eastertide pun, the future is a dicey subject. Last Thursday's Ascension was another turning point. The apostles and disciples returned to await the coming of the Spirit in the realization that our Lord could no longer be confined by space and time. The resurrection could not be just a going back to how things were. The exaltation of Jesus in glory after his rising had to lead somewhere new, the presence of the promised Spirit with us. At this point, it first becomes clear where the story of which we are now a part as the church is headed. It's not to be a museum record, this record of the resurrection. It's not to be a nostalgia cult, a return to the old familiar ways. No, as Jesus repeatedly challenged and often upset sensibilities and expectations during his life and ministry, so now he gives a clear signal that the resurrection is not to prompt a sigh of relief and a relaxation into the old ways. Nor is it a faith which is devoted to holding on to or preserving the past. The logic of Jesus being raised from the dead requires his leaving his disciples to wait for the coming of the Spirit. Otherwise, what would have happened? Would he have lived to a great old age? Would he have avoided further conflict with the Romans? Or would he have actually been in conflict with the Romans and died again? This time, peacefully, perhaps as a revered founder or a curious guru of a new Jewish sect. You know, everything that did follow, including the transformation of this small but burgeoning Jewish alternative religion, as it was looked at those days, into the good news for all people, required Jesus's departure. As the gospel wording puts it, he withdrew from them, but only having left them with a commission. Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. God entrusting us with his good news requires us to understand that in his love, he also trusts us with what will happen to it. We have often failed him, but we are now encouraged year on year. And this is one of the points of our festivals coming round and round again to renew us and to kickstart us again. We are now encouraged to pray, "Thy kingdom come," and to pray for the conversion of others, for the conversion of the nation, of the kingdom of God to come. God now entrusts us with the future. It was theirs. It's now ours. A spirit-driven responsibility. Let us rise to that challenge. Amen. And so we come now to our prayers of intercession. Jesus, our exalted and ascended Lord, has been given all authority. Let us seek his intercession, that our prayers may be perfected by his prayer. Jesus Christ, great High Priest, living forever to intercede for us, pray for the Church, your broken body in the world. We pray for Christopher and Richard, our bishops, for this diocese and all the parishes in it. We pray for churches together in Mitcham and our united mission. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jesus Christ, King of righteousness, enthroned at the right hand of the Majesty on high, pray for the world and make it subject to your gentle rule. Father, we pray for peace throughout the world, particularly at this time for peace in the Holy Land. We ask your blessing on all who make and strive for peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jesus Christ, Son of Man, drawing humanity into the life of God, pray for your sisters and brothers in need, distress, or sorrow. We pray especially for Joyce Pennells, Ivy Weir, Elaine Borer, Paul Loftus, Michelle Chameret, Irene Stansfield, Ron Clarkson, Sylvia Jackson, Claudette, Karen Pugh, Phil Parkinson, Dorothy Cummint Wood, Betty Smith, Paul Barry, and Chika Anunku. Lord, be with them in their troubles and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jesus, pioneer of our salvation, bringing us to glory through your death and resurrection, surround with your saints and angels those who have died trusting in your promises. We remember especially Dylan Callahan, Mary Hart, Linda Mackay, Chrissy Young, Leonard Young, and David Ofai Chinnery. We pray for those whose year's mind falls at this time. Rest eternal grant them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, Lord of all things, ascended far above the heavens and filling the universe, pray for us who receive the gifts you give us for work in your service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, keep the Church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace, and bring the whole created order to worship at your feet. For you are alive and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Will you please stand for the peace? Our Lord Jesus Christ says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. If you love me, rejoice, because I am going to the Father." Alleluia. May the peace of the Lord be always with you. Alleluia. And also with you. Alleluia. Let's offer one another a sign of peace if we're with others this morning. Otherwise, let us pray for those who we would otherwise be seeing and greeting at this time. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. And blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and the work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. Be present, Lord Jesus Christ, our risen and ascended High Priest. Make yourself known in the breaking of the bread. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, the King of glory. Born of a woman, he came to the rescue of our human race. Dying for us, he trampled death and conquered sin. By the glory of his resurrection, he opened the way to life eternal, and by his ascension gave us the sure hope that where he is, we may also be. Therefore, the universe resounds with Easter joy, and with choirs of angels we sing forever to your praise. Wonderful is your love, O Lord. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you have embraced us as your own. When we turned away, your love remained steadfast. You raised up Jesus, our Saviour, born of Mary, to be the living bread in whom all our hungers are satisfied. He offered his life for sinners, and with a love stronger than death, he opened wide his arms for us. On the cross. On the night before he died, he came to supper with his friends, and taking bread, he gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, taking a cup of wine, again he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Christ will come again. As we offer up these gifts of your creation, Father, may they be for us the body and the blood of your dear Son. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in your presence, form us in the likeness of Christ and build us into a living temple to your glory. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, Lord. Remember your church in every land. Reveal her unity, guard her faith, and preserve her in peace, so that with Mary, the Mother of God, Peter, Paul, and all the saints, we may share in the vision of that eternal splendor for which you have created us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, with songs of everlasting praise.
blessing and honour and glory and power be yours for ever and ever. Amen.
As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace. Hallelujah, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. The blood of Christ. Let us pray. Eternal God, giver of love and power, your Son Jesus Christ has sent us into all the world to preach the gospel of his kingdom. Confirm us in this mission and help us to live the good news we proclaim through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Amen indeed. And again, a very warm welcome to all to church this morning. It's good to have you with us. Today is Ascension Sunday, and next week is the Feast of the Pentecost, and we still have, therefore, 7 days to pray, Thy Kingdom Come. Please do look at the leaflet and notice the extra services which are on during this week, and do join us in our vigil of prayer. These 9 days are really important to bring home to us the importance of praying not only for ourselves and the church, but praying that other people may come to an understanding of Jesus Christ and may also join this community of praying Christians as we look to the coming of God's kingdom. Next Sunday is a very important day in the church's year, or rather our church's 2 years, as we will be holding our annual parochial church meeting and our annual meeting where we elect our church wardens. Now this means that there's quite a radical change next Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. At 10 o'clock next Sunday, we are inviting people into church for the service, and those people will be involved in the annual meeting directly at the end of the service next week. We will be broadcasting that service live, so please do come along at 10 o'clock as usual online, and you will see our parish Eucharist at the nave altar for a change, and we are using this as a trial to see how it actually turns out. So we will be filming until the almost conclusion of the service next Sunday, and then at 11 o'clock our annual meetings will commence. There's a short agenda. We are commanded to make sure that everything is kept as short as possible, and that will be shown on Zoom rather than on Facebook, which then enables people to directly see and ask questions if they so choose. So that is the arrangement for next week. As usual, come along at 10 o'clock. You will be very welcome, but you will be seeing the service from the main body of the church and joining others who are here with us. Do check your notice sheet as well. The usual service at 9:30 on Tuesday is happening, and there's another Eucharist later in the week. But please do look at the Thy Kingdom Come leaflet. That gives you all the definite dates and times. Meanwhile, take care, keep safe, and God bless you all. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
God the Father, who has given to his Son the name above every name, strengthen you to proclaim Christ Jesus as Lord. Amen. God the Son, who is our great High Priest, passed into the heavens, plead for you at the right hand of the Father. Amen. God the Holy Spirit, who pours out his abundant gifts upon the church, make you faithful servants of Christ our King. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.